this prayer this morning. My heart
needs to worship you. My soul lives in awe of you. My heart beats to worship you. My soul lives in awe of you. Holy, 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 holy is your name. God Almighty, you reign supreme in majesty. God of glory.
Amen. A lot of fun. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we worship you this morning. Thank you for who you are. We can have fun in the middle of your presence because of your grace, because of your mercy. We worship you. We give you praise. Ask for your blessing on the message service this morning. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. You can be seated if you're in the room.
Hey, good morning. It is Sunday morning there, and as I'm giving this sermon, it is Thursday afternoon here in Germany. And if I look a little squinter, like I'm in the sun, I have my windows open, and it's actually cloudy, but it's still really bright. But if I close them, it looks really dark and weird. So anyways, I feel like this is like a precursor to returning to the sunshine state. So it's great to see all of you. I feel like between my online Bible study on Wednesdays and my sermons that I've been preaching on video, I almost feel like I'm back there with you, although I'm not quite home. But believe me, I am ready to get home as much as anybody. As I mentioned last week, and I began this first of two in this sermon series, this is it. This is the last collared shirt I have in Germany. So I hope you enjoy it, because that's what you get. I will dress up, you know, I'll wear a different collared shirt when I'm with you in person. But for right now, this is all you get. Hey, it's good to see all of you. Next week, we are going to be back in the gymnasium, and that is exciting. So I know Rusty's going to announce it, and I know you're going to hear about it via email and Facebook. But remember that next week, Sunday the 21st, we're going to be back in the gym. I won't be, because I won't be there. But when I say we, I'm there in spirit. And hopefully it won't be too much longer until I'm there in body as well, spirit. All right, so I'm going to read today from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 11 to 21. Before I get started, what I want to do is actually begin with a word of prayer, and then we'll get into the message for today. So let's pray together. Father, we give you thanks and praise for this opportunity just to unpack your word, to be immersed in who you are and who you're calling us to be. And we ask, Lord, that your word would not return empty or void, but it would work its will and its way in our lives. We pray, Lord, that you'd get the preacher out of the way and help me to understand your word more clearly, and help all of us to have hearts that are open to what you have to say. But not just hearts that are open to what you have to say, but minds that will act upon your will and your call in our lives. So speak to us now, teach us, guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So this is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 11 to 21. And it begins like this. So this is Paul writing to the church at Corinth. He says, therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known to God, and hope it is known also to your conscience. We're not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast about an outward appearance and not about what is in the heart. For we are beside ourselves as for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for their sake and was raised. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, Christ God, or excuse me, that is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, but entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him who knew no sin to be sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Amen. Well, that scripture reading was a bit of a tongue twister. Hopefully the rest of the sermon will not be. But last week we were talking about fear. And one of the points I want to build upon is listening. If you remember, I tied this into Jesus' reaction to Peter. Remember, as Peter began to sink, due to lack of faith, due to paying attention to the winds, Jesus didn't harass him or criticize him. Instead, he reached out. As he pulled the sinking Peter up, he then did chide him for lack of faith, but the first thing he did was to reach out. My challenge to us is for us to listen to others actively, closely, with empathy, attempting to understand what they're saying, doing so without writing off their experience because it doesn't match our own experience. I've got a quote from the Irish writer John O'Donohue, who said this, quote, "We assume too readily that we share the one world with other people. It is true at the objective level that we inhabit the same physical space as other humans. The sky is, after all, the one visual constant that unites everyone's perception of being in the world. Yet this outer world offers no access to the inner world of the individual." So that's the Irish writer John O'Donohue. So when we assume the inner world of another is the same, we don't see or hear them. When we write off their perceptions because they don't match our own, we fail to see or hear them. This failure to listen creates conflicts and division. We end up creating our own narratives and then project them onto others in the process. And that creates a separation. When you no longer hear the other person, you begin to create ideas, motives, doubts, thought processes, things like that, which you then project on others. In marriages, it works like this. You assume that you understand what they want, what they don't want, what they need, what they don't need, what they think, what they don't think, and so on. You begin to take them and their feelings for granted until an event or a series of events shows just how far apart you really are. The person you assume you know isn't actually the one in front of you. A similar dynamic exists in friendships, workplace relationships, and so on. We're also seeing this at a societal level in the United States. I'm watching more and more estrangement grow between people of different politics, different creeds, different ethnicities, different countries of origin, and so on, and more like that. Our words are different. I'm reminded often by a friend when I'm preaching to ask, yeah, but what does this mean? If I want to be heard, I can't just throw out church words known by insiders and expect them to be understood by those who speak a different language. And I think there are two communication challenges right now that make this even more difficult. First, we lack commonly trusted news and editorial sources. In other words, we don't agree upon an unbiased source of information. It's easy to write off another person's opinion by saying things like, yeah, but that's on CNN, or no, that comes from Fox News, so no, take it seriously. When we make fun of the so-called liberal lamestream media, or we laugh off supposedly right-wing sources, it allows us to avoid even engaging different perspectives. Well, what if it does come from CNN? Or what if it does come from Fox? What if somebody who thinks differently than you is offering their perspective on the same thing, and maybe they're right? Or maybe at least they can add to the perspective. So that's the first communication challenge. The second one is that we have more and more information online, really, in particular, which is just flat out untrue. We don't take the time to spend 3 to 4 seconds to Google something and see other pictures, other stories, and try to discern whether or not we're really being told the whole story. We seem to be more interested in news which confirms a previously held opinion. You've all heard of confirmation bias. So we're more concerned with confirmation bias and whether or not we're passing on something untrue. I've seen people post things, and someone will say in the comments, well, this isn't true, and they'll kind of laugh it off as well, you know, but it, you know, blah, 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 you know, because it confirms what they believe to be true. And I can't really do that in camera, but on a big level, it confirms what they believe to be true. So it doesn't really matter the facts of it, because the heart or the thought behind it is true. For example, I've seen a post recently which shows the Lincoln Memorial practically destroyed by protesters. Maybe you've seen this, the same thing. It links to an article from, I think, the Washington Times, but the picture shows, you know, the statue, like, basically missing from this part of the head, and spray paint all over Lincoln's face and body. And it's not true. That didn't happen. Now, if you link to the article, somebody did write graffiti on something at the very entrance of Lincoln Memorial, not on the statue, not on the memorial itself. Maybe that's changed in the last day. Others have posted pictures of the Lincoln Memorial with green paint splattered upon it. The picture is real. However, it's from 7 years ago and has nothing to do with protests right now over the killing of George Floyd. I could go on and on. And there are examples from both the left and the right. Falsehood has become a bipartisan problem. I'm not picking on one side or the other. It's become a bipartisan problem. That makes the words of this reading that I just went through even more urgent. And so I want to focus on these few verses, which I'm going to read again. I'm going to read verses 7, 17 to 21. I'm going to read those again if you're in your Bibles. So I want to focus on those few verses, and I'm going to highlight three things I want to pull from those verses. So Paul says, verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is, number one, a new creation. We're going to come back to that. He's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God who, and this is the second part, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God is reconciling the world to himself, not counting the trespasses against them, and entrusting to us, and this is the third part, the message of reconciliation. The ministry, as you mentioned, verse 17, and the, or verse 18, and then in verse 19, the message. Okay. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. So three things. One, Paul calls us a new creation. Two, we're told that Christ reconciled us to himself. And then three, we have the ministry and message of reconciliation. So let's break those down. First of all, we're new creations. But what does it actually mean? This is a popular Christian phrase you can get on a coffee mug or a t-shirt or a stationery pad, or you can post the verse online. But what does it actually mean to be a new creation? So first of all, look at the context of the phrase. And by the way, I learned a while back from a friend of mine that co-text and context are not the same thing. The context is all the stuff. So context might be that Paul is writing to the Corinthians and he was writing about subject A, B, C, and D, and it was written around the year, 53 AD. You can see I'm doing this off the top of my head. The context is all the stuff surrounding what goes into the scripture reading. Co-text is literally that, the co-words, the co-text, what is being said around it. So when Paul calls us new creations, what is he saying? He says we're new and the old is past. He says this is from God. Before that, Paul speaks of not regarding anyone according to the flesh. That's the co-text. So let's summarize. The old is gone, the new nature is from God, and it's not a fleshling. It's not about, you know, what we see on the outside. So new creation isn't a workout program. It isn't a language we speak or a certain way we act. Rather, being a new creation is about having eternal nature and interacting with people according to that nature. You are a spirit-filled, Bible-believing, Jesus-saved Christian. And as a new creation, then you interact with people according to that. You know, at the chapel, we don't have this as much at Beachside. But think about in my chapel service, we've got a wide variety of ages. And what we do at Beachside as well, but we're talking about 19-year-old privates to, you know, 75-year-old retirees. We've got various languages. We've got various, well, there's two genders. We've got various races. We've got various educations. We've got various ranks in the military. And we have something similar at Beachside. That's what heaven will look like. It'll be people all across creation. And so we consider each other not according to the flesh, an American Christian versus a German Christian versus a Nepali Christian or whatever. But we consider each other as new creations of God. We're going to live eternally. If the people around you are eternal, doesn't that change your opinion of them? So Paul says, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Instead, we've been reconciled with God, and this has instilled within us the new creation. So we're the new creation. We speak to each other as those who've been redeemed by Christ, are full of the Spirit, and we live eternally. That's what it means to be a new creation. The second part, then, is this whole business about reconciliation. So to understand reconciliation, that God reconciled us in Christ, we begin by asking, okay, how did we become unreconciled? I mean, what is unreconciled? And how did we become unreconciled? Well, to be unreconciled is an admission that our accounts with God are uneven. Let me say that again, and I'll slow down. To be unreconciled is an admission that our accounts with God are not even. We are imperfect, immortal beings. God is a perfect, immortal being. We are limited. God is all-powerful. Our knowledge is limited. God is omniscient. Our love is limited. Our empathy is limited. God's love is forever and eternal and more than we can comprehend. So saying we're unreconciled is, first of all, it's a general realization. It's a general realization that collectively something is off. I could point to the current events. Isn't the current state of race relations a sign of sin at some level? Of course it is. Aren't the divisions in our politics a sign of sin? I'm not talking about the fact that people hold different opinions. It is not sinful for one person to say, I believe in limited government, and for another person to say, I want the government to be bigger. The way we talk to each other, especially right now, that is sin. It's not sin to have different opinions. We're going to have different opinions about the best way to provide health care. That's fine. But when we begin to dehumanize and disrespect others because they hold a different opinion, that's when sin has begun to creep in. Or what about the environmental damage caused by humans? You don't have to be an environmentalist to acknowledge that. You think about what is called the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. It's an area of floating, mostly plastic. From what I saw, not of the patch, but the research online, it's apparently roughly twice the size of Texas. Now, maybe I'm missing something there. Maybe it's only the size of Texas or half the size of Texas. But isn't that sin? All that stuff that we just discard? I mean, imagine how you would respond if someone stayed in your home. It could be your kids, it could be visitors, it could be friends, and trashed it. Your attitude would be, clean this up right now, right? Make it right. So there's a general realization that something's off. We know things are not the way they're supposed to be. But then there's also a specific realization in ourselves that something's off. You know that you do wrong. You've hurt people, you've disobeyed God. You've contributed to messes at home, at work, with friends. And odds are, the older you get, the more aware you are that things aren't right. We try to make it right, but we will never get it perfect. So our accounts with God are a bit off, right? We've got a specific realization that somehow things are not the way they're supposed to be. And so our accounts aren't even with God. They start to get uneven when we sin. Something which demands payment. And I'll use an illustration, a couple of them, from life. Let's say you go to the library. You borrow a book. What are you required to do? Return it. Okay, you have the book until whatever, July 3rd, and then you have to return it. And if you don't, you have to pay a fine. Or if you lose a book, you have to pay for the book. You may not like it, and you may stop borrowing books from the library, but it's fair. They lent you a book, you must return it. And if you don't, you have to pay for it. Another example, you're at a store and it's got a sign that says, you break it, right? You buy it. You break it, you buy it. Why? Because there's a sense that if you break someone else's stuff, you need to make restitution. Our civil and criminal judicial systems are based on a sense of fairness. Financial systems are built this way. One of the worst burdens is to have debts you can't handle. Think about how awful it feels to owe money. Some of you have experienced that. Others are burdened by unsustainable debt right now. To pay it off seems like a dream, but it is humanly possible for the most part. Spiritually speaking, it's impossible. We have debts that can never be repaid. And some people spend their lives trying to make God happy. They know instinctively something is off, but their solution is, well, I need to stop doing wrong and only do right. And, you know, my answer is, well, good luck then. That's what it means to be unreconciled. So what does it mean to be reconciled then? It means that we're back in harmony, that we're compatible, that we're on an even footing, that we're forgiven. Again, using the bank illustration, it's to make sure the figures align. When you reconcile your checkbook, you're making sure what you think you have is what the bank thinks you have. What you think should be paid, the bank has paid or believes will be paid. Friends, our accounts with God aren't right. To be reconciled means they're made right. And here's the catch. We can't do it ourselves. God in Christ does it for us. Jesus took on the debt we owed. God saw our sin, knew we couldn't take care of ourselves, and came to make it right himself. It's offered to you as a free gift. And receiving gift, even that isn't a merit, right? It's not a credit, it's not a good work. Who would refuse a free gift? And who gets credit for receiving a gift? You're really a holy person because you said yes to that gift. I suppose somebody might receive a gift, but you get the point. And you certainly don't get credit for saying yes. God offers life and forgiveness out of love for us. Then, knowing that we're reconciled to God, the third part, we reconcile. We've been given a ministry of reconciliation and the message of reconciliation. We now have the job of making things right with the people around us. We finally get to what Paul is saying about our role. We've been given a ministry, that's verse 18, and a message, verse 19, both of reconciliation. In other words, we have to work and we have things to say about reconciliation. It's not passive. This isn't a call to be ministers of reconciliation if the time is right or someone is really open to us. We have to be proactive. The big issue right now, in the U.S. at least, is race relations. Let's name that. It's okay to say those words out loud, to acknowledge that a chasm has been growing for centuries. My question is, do you believe God is at work in this? I see lots of people take a passive, almost escapist attitude toward it. It's almost as if they're hoping that Jesus will come back so they don't have to have tough conversations. Moreover, there are those that dismiss important conversations because they point, well, there's people rioting and looting. I got it. And there are people doing awful things over there and awful things over there. But conflict unresolved only escalates. The riots and looting only point to the greater problems we need to solve. And by the way, please understand, I am not defending rioting and looting at all. What I'm saying is their presence at some level points to the fact that things are messed up and have to be messed up. I challenge you to look at it from a different perspective. Maybe God is active in this whole thing. Rather than being away and gone and we just hope that Jesus comes back and gets us, maybe what we need to say is God is active. What if this is part of a new creation? I mean, after all, isn't June 2020 not May 2020, for better or for worse? We see throughout Scripture that God works in the midst of human pain and human brokenness. But I think it's interesting that when things are difficult, so many people assume that this isn't of God. What does this say about our understanding of God? That we always see him at work in peace, good stock markets, in harmony. When God is only active when things are going really well. And when things are bad, it must be the work of the devil. And it must be the sign of the end. What if God is pushing us to move through difficult times to be ministers of reconciliation and preach words of hope? Friends, that's why we need the salvific word of Christ. One died for all. Think about that. One died for all. That message is where reconciliation begins. If we're reconciled to God, we must preach that same message to others. First, we preach that they can be reconciled to God, and second, that they're called to be reconciled to others. We're not called to retreat from the world. We're called to engage it and to preach that message of hope and reconciliation. And that call comes right in conflict with American individualism. And I am pro-American, so please, I've got a German flag over my head, but understand, this is not saying America's bad, but we have to do some cultural self-critique. And one of our weaknesses is this cultural message that's all about me and my happiness and my prosperity, and it's not. We're called to live not for ourselves, but for others. We're called to live for ourselves, but to live for a higher purpose. We're in this together. Last week, you remember that I quoted 1 Corinthians 12, verse 26, if one part of the body hurts, the whole body hurts. We are not islands. If one part of the body hurts, the whole body hurts. And friends, the body is hurting. And as Christians, we have to stand at the forefront. Think about MLK, Martin Luther King Jr. Who was he named for? Well, if you're smart aleck, you would say Martin Luther King Sr. Yes, he was. Who is he named for? He changed his name to honor Martin Luther. His dad, Martin Luther King Sr., changed his name, and so Martin Luther King Jr. did as well. You certainly remember what Martin Luther, not Martin Luther King, but Martin Luther was famous for. Right? A pastor here in Germany. I've been to the church where he stayed when he was confronting the Pope down in Augsburg. Martin Luther King, what was his occupation? Yeah, he was a pastor. Think about that. This is our fight. The abolitionists were infused with faithful Christian leadership. That is the ones who wanted to abolish slavery. Same thing with the civil rights movement. Friends, if we don't lead the way, someone else will that preaches a different message. If we don't lead the way, we leave the fight to someone else. We cannot turn our backs at this time. If not us, who? If not us, who? Ultimately, if we're reconciled to God, and we are, then we have a mission in this kingdom. Think of the Lord's Prayer. So there's two paths. First, escaping the mission. And we're going to come back to the Lord's Prayer in a second. I know I said think of the Lord's Prayer. We're going to. The first path is to escape the mission. This is Christianity, which buries its head in the sand and says, well, Jesus is going to return. We just need to be ready for the rapture. Okay, fine. So what's the best way to get ready? To be found doing the things of God and that's the second path, embracing the mission. This is the second path. It's the preferred path. So now think about the Lord's Prayer. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You're praying that God's will be done on earth. Who will God use? Us. God will use us. So we recognize finally that reconciliation isn't just about words. God wants to use us. Jesus died on the cross. Think about that. That was an action. I imagine God, because he's omniscient, omniscient and omnipotent, all-powerful, all-knowing, could have just said, hey, I forgive you. That would be fine. But words are always paired with actions. In 12-step program, addicts speak of making amends, right? 12-step programs, one of the steps, it's like, what, step 5, 6, somewhere there? I apologize, I don't know. Addicts speak of making amends. They take actions to go along with their words. So what does that mean in the current situation? I don't know, but I'm listening and I'm hoping to learn. What I do know is that more was taken from the Floyd family than the system could ever give back to them. No one can bring George back from the dead. Nevertheless, we don't rest. We are called to preach Christ to and in the current situation. Violence, brutality, death, destruction of property. None of that has the last word. We've seen the craziness. On the one hand, you have people who are mocking the Floyd death. I saw this article. They were mocking the Floyd death by reenacting it in New Jersey. They were sitting there waving people, and they were reenacting. They had signs, and what the signs said. But they don't have the last word. And then there are people that are taking advantage of the chaos to loot and to destroy. They don't have the last word. Jesus does. So now is the time to decide. Will you be a minister of reconciliation? Will you preach Christ crucified? Will you be at the forefront of calling the world, be reconciled to God and be reconciled to each other? The time to decide is now. Amen. It's been good to see you. I know I'm not with you. I know I'm not there. But I do miss all of you. And even just this preaching has been difficult at times. You know, uploading this sermon with my internet connection, it takes a couple hours. And it's going to take a couple hours to upload this. I can't wait to fly home and see all of you and be with all of you. What I want to do now is close with prayer. And then we're going to close with the words, go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. So let's pray, and then we'll say those words together. And you guys have an incredible rest of your day. So let's pray. Father, we give you thanks and praise that in the name of Jesus, we are reconciled, that we've been reconciled to God. And now we have the call to go and be reconciled to others. Help us to be at the forefront of preaching this message and sharing with the world that in Jesus there's love and in Christ there's hope. Help us to preach a message of reconciliation in God, that in Christ, God is not counting our sins against us, but forgiving them and making us new. And then as new creations, we don't regard people from the perspective of flesh anymore, but we love them as brothers and sisters in Christ. So be with us now. Guide us, encourage us, renew us in Jesus' name. Amen. So friends, now we say, go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. God bless you.